So buonasera, good evening to everyone. My name is Arianna Dagnino and I am the coordinator of cultural events organized by the Dante Alighieri Society of BC here in Vancouver. On behalf of the Dante Society, I will welcome you tonight to this event, The Language of Music, an Italian Affair, with Maestro Carlo Fierens. I thank the Consul General of Italy, Fabio Messineo, for being here with us tonight, together with the president of our society, Dr. Stefano Gulmanelli. I would also like to thank the Consulate General of Italy for their support in organizing this event, which is part of the celebrations for the 20th week of the Italian language in the world. Let me just spend a few words about our organization. The Dante Alighieri Society of BC is a non-profit organization whose mission is the promotion of Italian language and culture. It offers online courses of Italian language at all levels through the Dante Italian Language School. You can find more information about this on our website. Also, I would like to tell you that throughout the year, we organize cultural events such as this, and with different formats, webinars, conferences, workshops. Follow us and support us by becoming a member of our society. The yearly memberships costs only $30 and gives access to a series of discounts and benefits, especially if there are courses which are sometimes paying courses, short courses or small webinars. You will find all the relevant information again on our website and also on our Facebook page. And now let me introduce Maestro Carlo Fierens, tonight's speaker. Born and raised in Italy, Carlo Fierens obtained a master's degree in guitar at the Trento Conservatory and also a doctorate degree at the Indiana University. He has performed across America, Europe, and Asia in prestigious venues, such as the Kennedy Center in Washington and the Munetsugu Hall in Nagoya in Japan. He has been featured extensively on radio and TV in Italy and abroad. I would like to thank Maestro Carlo Fierens for waking up at 4 a.m. in the morning to share with us his knowledge of Italian music and the rich heritage that goes with it. Carlo is connecting from Italy, from the small town of Mondovì in the Piedmont region, which is a beautiful town with a beautiful historical center. So let's welcome Maestro Carlo Fierens to our virtual podium for an exciting musical and linguistic tour across the centuries. And now I leave the podium to Carlo Fierens.
Thank you, Arianna. Thank you, everybody, for joining. Yes, just a little technical thing before we start. Please let us know if something is wrong in the connection, in the video, in the audio, because this is all about music. And so if music cannot reach you, then that's a problem. So thank you everybody for being here. Thank you to Dr. Arianna Dagnino and Professor Stefano Gulmanelli for organizing this, to the Dante Society of British Columbia for inviting me, and to the Consulate General of Italy in Vancouver for helping making this happening. In this lecture, well, first let me tell you that this originally was supposed to be a lecture recital or a recital followed by a lecture or a lecture followed by a recital, but it was supposed to happen live in Vancouver. But then you all know what happened in the world in the recent months. And so Arianna and Stefano had the brilliant idea of making this an online event, which, as I mentioned before, is not exactly the same. It's actually completely different, but it allows me to reach you with my music in some ways. So I'm really grateful for this to happen. and hopefully we'll get the chance to meet in real sooner than later. Okay, so my idea is to share with you a presentation, a series of slides that we will comment together, and you will be able to hear some musical samples that I chose for you. And at the end, some guitar pieces that well fit in the discourse played by myself. So let's see if this works. I'm gonna share the slides with you. Share screen. And I will share this PowerPoint. That's it. Okay, and you tell me if this is working. I see Silvia happy with the results, so I'm happy as well. Okay, thank you. Okay, this is the last slide, so this is not exactly what I wanted, but okay, and this is the first slide. Okay, all right. So before we actually start, there's another quick disclaimer. I will keep the language for this entire lecture PG rated, so it's going to be suitable for children, except for one single slide. But it's not my fault, it's Mozart's, so I feel excused for that. And and anyway, it's nothing too bad. It's nothing that you cannot see in any, I mean, Simpson episode or something. So, but I wanted to let you know, and you will see when that slide is coming. So, okay, so Italian and music. There are several facets of this rich relationship between our language, Italian, and music. And I'd like to start by emphasizing two of them, which are different, but also complementary in a way, and we'll see how. The first one is something that you all probably know, and that is the predominance of Italian language in music lingo. And I give you several examples in a moment. The second one is the importance of some Italian genres, mainly art song and opera, of course, in the history of Western music. Now, as I already said, the two are really deeply connected. And during the lecture, we'll try to see how. About the first aspect of the importance of Italian music, you probably know that there are some Italian terms like tempo, adagio, allegretto, rallentando, that are musical directions that are used only in the context of reading and writing music. So chances are that, you know, probably everyone has heard these terms before, but any musician, any classically trained musician in the world would know these terms. But, you know, these terms are used only when making music, when teaching music, when reading music. There are other terms though, and I can think of concerto, piano, soprano, the term opera itself, that were so stylish that they have made their way from their original Italian into English everyday music vocabulary. So some terms crept into English, into the English dictionary. And they're commonly used, sometimes even not only in a strictly musical context. And it was not only the terms that were taken on, But European and then also American composers also adopted compositional forms that had an Italian name and were originated in Italy. I can think about the already mentioned, and we will mention that a lot, opera, but also the sonata, the cantata. All of these are Italian names for specific genres of classical music, which were created in Italy and then were exported all over Europe and the Americas as well. And they changed a lot, but they kept the Italian name. I can think about the sonata, for example. The great evolution of the sonata as a form happened actually in Austria and Germany in the 19th century. But despite that, the composers always kept the Italian name for it. What's more, Italian musical instrument makers, such as Stradivari, Guarneri, Amati, all of these are very, very famous violin makers from the Baroque period, also contributed to establish this sort of Italian supremacy over classical music. And this is just to state, you know, plain facts, you know, Italian terms used in musical genres and in musical lingo. But there is another layer to that. So I wanted to get a little deeper into that. And that layer is that Italian itself is often called a naturally musical language. So there is something fitting in the fact that it's the language that's used for musical directions, right? And first of all, just to get clear, this isn't to say that every composer has stuck to the standard, starting as early as with Beethoven, that we will see in a minute. He is the one, the German composer, who started to use musical directions also in German, in his scores. Or in a different country, starting with Debussy, he started to use indication in French. And also, I want to mention right now that there are words from other language as well that made it into the musical lingo. I can think about French, for example, with the word encore, which is used typically in normally in English speaking countries, and also German. I can think about the Wagnerian term leitmotiv, which is now commonly used in music and not only in music context. So let's dig a little deeper into this idea that Italian itself is a musical language. And I wanted to start by this quote by Jean-Jacques Rousseau that you can read in this slide, and I will read for you anyways. Rousseau, of like the famous French philosopher, though he was born in Switzerland, he was a musician himself. You know, not everybody knows that, but he was a trained composer. He even composed an opera. So what's Rousseau's thesis in this essay called the Essay on the Origin of Language? He claims that language, as well as the human race, developed in southern warm climates and then migrated northwards to colder climates. Okay, of course, there's not any scientific evidence for this, but that's just his theory. So in this inception, language was musical and had emotional power as opposed to rational persuasion. The colder climates of the North, however, stripped language of its passionate characteristic, distorting it to the present rational form. So according to Rousseau, language started from music. It's actually a decay, a deformation of music, and therefore language lost the original qualities of music. Of all the languages, though, Italian, according to Rousseau, is the language that kept this link with the natural musicality of humankind more tighter. So he said, if to be asked, and I quote, if to be asked what nation would have the best music, I would answer that whose language is best adapted to music. Now, if there be in Europe a language adapted to music, it is certainly the Italian, for that language is sonorous, harmonious, and more accented than any other, which four qualities are precisely those which are the most proper for singing. And end quote. And he goes on by demonstrating this this theory with a series of pseudo empirical proofs for this argument, the third of which consists of a story about an Armenian visitor to Venice who has no previous experience in music before, and he, Rousseau, attests to having witnessed an event during which French music by Rameau, by the composer Rameau, was performed, and then Italian music was performed before this Armenian visitor. This Armenian, you should remember, was never exposed to music before. And Rousseau said that he was indifferent to French, to the French singing, but then he was moved to tears with an Italian song by Galuppi, by the way. So of course, these are, there's not any scientific evidence for what Rousseau is claiming. But it tells us that it was common knowledge that Italian was a very musical language, and it has a special connection with music itself. Let's see very quickly a few examples of the first facet of this relationship that I mentioned. So the use of Italian directions in musical scores. This is just an opportunity for me also to show you some handwriting from some of the most famous composers of our Western canon and see how they write their directions in their scores in Italian. I wanted to start with Johann Sebastian Bach, which is by many regarded as the father of the great European, specifically German music. This is a score you can see. I'm always impressed by how beautiful is Bach handwriting. This is the manuscript of the first violin sonata, the first solo violin sonata, one of the most important pieces in the violin repertoire. And you can see that the title for this, it says Sonata Prima a Violino Solo Senza Basso di Johann Sebastian Bach. So the title itself is in Italian. But let's try to understand, it's impossible to understand from this page, although we have some hints. Let's try to understand whether Bach was actually fluent in Italian. And the answer is no, okay? So is we know that Bach was, as any other musician of the time, he was exposed a lot to Italian music, but we also know that Bach never traveled outside Germany, today's Germany. He was not really a traveler, although we have an account of him walking 200 miles just to hear a concert of a famous organist of the time, Buxtehude. So he apparently he loved to walk a lot, but not to travel too much out of his native country. So what we can expect from him, given that we don't have many accounts from his life, any biographical accounts, is that he knew the music vocabulary, the Italian vocabulary, just enough to be proficient in that. And we get a hint from this page. First of all, the other Italian word that appears is the adagio. You can see right after, right below the first line of music to the left, which is a tempo marking. So the speed of the movement. So when he says sonata prima, a violino solo, it's not, I mean, I want you to understand that you don't need to know Italian to write this, this title. It's like for a mathematician using a formula, because this is just a few keywords put together, few keywords that were commonly used in Italian, but where he actually needs to use some grammar, then there he actually makes a mistake, because he uses what's more like a French use of prepositions. So instead of using sonata per violino solo, like an Italian would say, he says sonata a violino solo, which is more typical of a French construction of the phrase. So he is completely okay when it comes to use the single words, but then when it comes to put together a phrase, we can see that some problems emerges, and it's a problem also for the Italian of that age. Okay, so it sounds an old Italian, but actually it's not very common in also in the Italian of that age. So let's move on. I want to show a few different examples. The other example is from another great Baroque composer, also born in Germany. As a matter of fact, born the exact same year as Johann Sebastian Bach, 1685, and Georg Friedrich Händel, which is often spelled as George Frederick Händel because he spent the last decades of his life in England, working as an opera composer. So often his name is quoted in with the English transliteration. Now, as opposed to Bach, Händel was a traveler. He traveled a lot all over Europe. He enjoyed great fame as a composer, while Bach was famous in his native country, mainly as an organist. And he spent a few years in Italy, mainly in Rome. And so in some of his compositions of the Italian years, we have some Italian cantatas, especially by Handel, we can see his name spelled in Italian. And you can see in this is not Handel handwriting, but it's by another musician. He writes Giorgio Federico, abbreviated Handel. And then the score begins. So I just wanted to show you how many composers were actually traveling to Italy for training, and also because Italy was a land of opportunities at that time for musicians, and so it was quite common for musicians to get acquainted to the Italian language. Also, let's not forget that while Bach never composed operas, Handel actually composed many Italian operas. So we can really expect that he was perfectly fluent in Italian. Actually, we know that he was. After all, he spent in Italy, if I'm not mistaken, at least 4 years of his life. Moving on, because these are just some very quick examples that I wanted to give you, to the greatest name of all the Western canon, so Ludwig van Beethoven, again, just to make it very brief, Beethoven never traveled to Italy, never moved a lot out of his native Germany and Austria, where he spent most of his life in Vienna. And we can see the same, again, tempo marking, Allegro assai, this is a violin sonata in G major. We can see also the title to the right, which is Sonata 32. And also this dynamic instruction, so the P that you see in the score stands for piano, and the F, the second, well, would be the fourth line from the beginning, the F is means forte, so loud. Again, we know from several accounts, we have many more informations about Beethoven lines for sure. And we know that he was not fluent in Italian. And also, as I mentioned before, he was the one who started to actually use his native language to give musical directions to musicians in his scores. Another page from Beethoven, this is, I wanted to include because it's the very famous, it's the beginning of a movement of the very famous Ninth Symphony. This is Beethoven's own handwriting. It's a sketch for his Ninth Symphony. And this is not very visible, but you can notice if watching closely that the instrument list, what you have on the left is the instrument list for the orchestra. So the name of the instrument are all in Italian, from oboe, clarinetto, violoncello, corni. So all the names of the instruments are in Italian. Also the tempo marking at the top, so adagio molto, so very slow, and cantabile, which like could be translated as sing-like. So I mentioned Bach, I mentioned Handel, I mentioned Beethoven. Who is missing? Of course, Mozart. Mozart, the other great name of the of Western canon. Excuse me. Is the example that I want to leave for last, because he is the composer of whom we know that he was very fluent in Italian, almost as a native language, and because he traveled to Italy several times. As a young boy with his father. On the right, you see actually the itinerary for his first Italian journey. He was coming, of course, from Austria, from his native Salzburg, and so traveled all the way through the Südtirol region, and then traveling through Trento, Rovereto, and then moving southern to Verona, Mantua, Cremona. And on his first journey, he went down, moving through Bologna and reaching Rome and Naples, enjoying great popularity as an enfant prodige. He was performing music on the keyboard, on violin, and also composing, as you know, despite the young age. As you probably know, he started composing at the age of around 6. So he was really a prodigy, obviously. And so he enjoyed great success in Italy. As a matter of fact, he came back 2 other times for shorter trips, the last of which for a performance of his opera, of an opera in the Lucio Silla in Milan. So by all these accounts, and also especially by his own letters, we know that he was speaking fluent Italian alongside his native German, actually his native dialect that was spoken in Salzburg, and alongside French, English, we can guess, because he spent several months of his life in London, and Latin, because he was taught Latin when he was a young kid. So we can move to music. The first music example that I wanted to give you is a composition that shows us since I wanted to find something interesting related to language, this composition shows us the grasp of Mozart over these different languages. And I'm going to explain the content of this canon. It's a lesser known composition, K, now it's cataloged as K559. A canon is a vocal composition where each voice enters singing the same melody. And you can hear it's very obvious here. Let's listen to this short piece of music, and then I will comment and I will try to tell you why it's very important when it comes to Mozart and his grasp of Italian language, and not only. Let's see if it works. I don't remember if I checked the right thing to make sound shareable. So you tell me by moving your thumb if you can hear. Okay, I will stop it, stop share, and I will resume it in a moment, but I need to start a new sharing with the option of making audio available for you. Share computer sound, and now I think it should work. Okay, let's try again.
Difficile le fumi mas et ionicu difficile le fumi mas minimas et tu difficile le tu ionico difficile, difficile lectumimas et ionico difficile, difficile lectumimas et ionico difficile.
Okay, I don't feel bad by stopping it because clearly this is not a musical masterpiece. It's just a musical joke. And here you have the lyrics in Latin. And I wanted to say from the beginning that the lyrics don't make any sense in Latin. It's just few Latin words put together. There's really no meaning at all. But here it comes the kind of a translation that you can make out of it. And so this is the only time where this lecture is becoming vulgar, but as I said, it's not my fault. And I will try to keep it as clean as possible anyway. So this is the line in Latin, difficile lectu mihi mars et ionicu, which as I said, doesn't make any sense. But this work is full, this canon is full of bilingual puns. You know, the lyrics are in Latin, but it was conceived to be sung by German singers. And Mozart knew that any German would pronounce the Latin lectu mihi mars in the way that you can read transliterated in the second line. In which, you know, it's German, but I think any English speaker can easily translate that. It's a common insult actually this is the Bavarian accent, more specifically Bavarian dialect, which means, well, you know, kiss my something. That's a little German pun inserted into the Latin line, but then he repeats a lot this word ionic, which said, you know, continuously said, creates actually the word cuioni, which, you know, any Italian speaker would understand that sounds pretty much like the word testicles in Italian, the vulgar word for it. So this is a joke that Mozart was presenting to his friends, and it shows how well he mastered cursing in different languages. And we know from letters, from other accounts, that was quite a habit by Mozart. He actually displayed frequent scatological humor in his letters and many recreational compositions like this. Some scholars try to explain it by even some claim that Mozart has Tourette syndrome, but of course there's no evidence for that. This theory has been dismissed over and over again. We need to understand that this kind of humor was actually very common in his, even in higher society of that time in Germany. We have, you know, even Martin Luther was using these kind of puns. We have several examples from Goethe. So not exactly, you know, humoristic writers that nevertheless in their letters, in their more, you know, humoristic output, they were using these puns and this kind of brilliantly vulgar humor. So this is I wanted to mention that there are several of these works that have really explicit lyrics, and after the death of Mozart, many of these compositions were given new lyrics just to make them sellable to the public. So publishers were eager to have new Mozart compositions after his death. And so they were also trying to use these lesser known works, but of course by putting new lyrics to them and made them, you know, more you know, suitable for any audience. I wanted to stay on Mozart because Mozart, as I mentioned, he spent some time in Italy, and he was fluent in Italy, and he composed, he was a great composer of Italian opera. And some of his Italian operas, the librettos were written by a very famous librettist of the time, Lorenzo da Ponte. Nowadays, we know Lorenzo da Ponte mainly from his collaboration with Mozart for three of the most important operas by Mozart. So Le Nozze di Figaro, this is the chronological order, Il Don Giovanni, and Così fan tutte. I wanted to spend a few words on da Ponte because he had a very interesting life, very adventurous life, in fact. He was born in the Venetian Republic. He was a priest, but later on he married. He had a very adventurous life. He was the official librettist in the Imperial Vienna, which tells us that we should remember that the official Imperial Theater in Vienna of the Austrian Empire was producing Italian operas mainly. So Italian opera was the official musical genre in Vienna at that time. And he was for some years, the official librettist. So he worked with Mozart, he worked with Salieri, with Martine Soler, another famous composer of the time. And I wanted to mention him also because after he lost his job in Vienna, he started to travel a bit over Europe. He moved first to London, And then he moved to the United States, to several states in the United States, finally settling down in New York, where he also worked as a butcher in a grocery shop. And later he started a bookshop of his own. And he was in the later years of his life, he was teaching Italian for the Columbia University of New York. And in fact, even today, the core of the Italian collection of the Italian library in the Columbia University is made of books that belonged to Lorenzo da Ponte. He died pretty old, as you can see. And so he had a very long and adventurous life that he tells us about in his memoir that are a very fun reading. And I don't want to get too much into the operas, because these operas by Mozart with the libretto by da Ponte are very famous and they're very rich in any aspect. They're great operas. But I want to mention da Ponte also because he is the receiver of one of the last letters that we know by Mozart, in which a letter that is written by Mozart in Italian to da Ponte, in which he is talking about the Requiem, so the famous composition that Mozart left unfinished. So it's interesting that he mentioned this composition, that, you know, one of the most famous compositions by Mozart, in Italian. So if you cannot read it, I will read it for you, just the most important part. He continues, Mozart says in Italian, I would say, and it's, as we said before, it's a perfectly spelled Italian. I can't get rid of the image of this stranger. I continue to see him. He begs me, he pushes me, and restlessly asks for my work. I go on working because composing is less tiring than resting. Moreover, I have nothing more to fear. I can tell from my condition that the hour is striking. I am about to breathe my last. I have come to the end of my life before having the full enjoyment of my talent. And he also says, this is my funeral chant. I can't leave it unfinished. So this letter well pairs with the tale of this mysterious visitor asking Mozart to compose this final requiem, which becomes actually, ironically, the funeral chant for Mozart himself. This tale is also portrayed in the Academy Award-winning movie Amadeus by Milos Forman. So this letter is very important because it's a letter to da Ponte that actually, supports this story, this compositional story of the Requiem. So it would be perfect, except it's fake. It's a fake letter written in the early Romantic era. So scholars were debating a lot whether this letter were real or just faked. And then they established that it was a fake letter just to support this romantic claim of Mozart composing his own funeral chant. In fact, we know that the composition of the Requiem that indeed was left unfinished was much more, straightforward. He had a commission by a nobleman, and he was actually not able to finish because of his illness and other commitments. But again, the Romantic, also pushed by his widow Costanze, had all the interest of portraying Mozart, as you can see in this picture, also a Romantic print of the time of Mozart laying in his bed composing the last bars of his requiem while the visitor is leaving, and his pupil Sus Meyer, who actually completed the requiem as we hear it today in concert, listening for the instructions from the master. Okay, so we have seen how Mozart was a great composer of opera, and I wanted to very quickly mention a few facts about Italian opera and why it surged and why it became so important in Italian music before we move on to the actually performed part. So a few examples of few musical moments where you can see the importance of Italian language in the development of this genre. First, I wanted to mention also a few important people in this evolution. The first one is not really very famous now as a composer of music. He's Vincenzo Galilei is mostly famous because he was the father of Galileo Galilei, the famous astronomer. But he was mainly a great musical theorist and a composer himself. And he's very important, together with all other many other musicians that rotated in this in his circle of friends and intellectual in Florence in the 16th century, because this composer started to think a new way of dealing with music and language. I wanted to play for you an example of a madrigal. So the musical style that was most common for composers at that time in order to set a text. It's sung by a choir, so by different voices at the same time. So this is what a madrigal sounded like pretty much in the age that we are talking about now. Okay, just a few seconds so that you have an idea. So it's different layers, different voices together with great rhythmic complexity. Now, some composers started to think that this was not the best way to help people understand the meaning of the lyrics. And so they wanted to search for a more direct way of treating treating poetry. Getting inspiration from Greek drama that at that time was common knowledge that it was sung all the way through. So they switched, many of them switched to a single voice singing accompanied by an instrument. One example of that could be by the famous composer Giulio Caccini, who is one of the fathers of Baroque opera. And this is a song composed by Caccini. We'll also listen to a few seconds just to that you can hear the difference in style. Here we have a single voice singing with a lute or a guitar accompanying. It's coming.
Thank you.
Okay, so as you can see, it's a very expressive setting for a single voice, following closely the accents of the of each word of each sentence. So this is a new style that was introduced at that age, and this opened the way for opera, for the modern arias as we know them, to be composed. The style itself is called recitar cantando. So just reading a text by singing, which started to be the model for all musical setting of any text. So this is the beginning of opera, and I wanted to show just a couple of spots where opera got in later years of full development. Just a couple of examples before we move to the guitar part. One is by one of the most famous opera composer, Rossini, who was a very famous starting in his 20s. He was that famous that and that he's really one of the composers who made a great living out of his music. In fact, he was able to retire at the age of 40, and because he didn't need to compose anymore just to make a living out of it. So he retired in his 40s after the Guillaume Tell, which is his last opera, and he moved to Paris, where his main occupation became eating and cooking. He was a passionate amateur chef himself. In fact, there are still a number of dishes named after Rossini to these days. He himself claimed that he had cried only three times in his life. The first time when his first opera didn't enjoy the success he was hoping for. The second time when he heard Niccolò Paganini playing violin. And the third time where he accidentally dropped during a trip on a boat, he dropped in the river a plate with truffles. So he was really passionate about eating as much as about music. And just to make it quick, he was really a master in reinterpreting the lyrics of his a libretto, so of the Italian text, in a musical way, so that the music enhance the overall effect of the text. A very powerful example of this is a sextet of the second act of the Cenerentola, which is nothing as the Cinderella tale, one of his most famous opera. This is a sextet, so six people singing together. It's a moment of maze, of bafflement, where each you have the lyrics on the left with a translation, which is not an exact translation, because the effect that you will hear now is, I would say, even more important than the words, because you will hear a lot of rolling R's, of popping P's that enhance this feeling of a tangled knot, that of the amazement of the characters that are singing. So let me play it very quickly for you. It's pretty evident and really amazing the result, the musical effect that he achieves.
Siete voi. Il caso è bello.
Accetta!
Ma mio cervello.
Silenzio!
Silenzio!
Che sta? è uno va inubato, questo gruppo ritrecciato.
Questo è un quinto avvistato, questo è un gruppo ritrecciato. Questo è un gruppo, questo è un gruppo ritrecciato. Chi più gruppo, più un gruppo, questo è un gruppo ritrecciato. Questo non va filuppato, questo gruppo ritrecciato. Chi sviluppa, chi viluppa, chi più sgruppa.
I hope you got what I was talking about. This crisp pronunciation of each word sounded like a canon, the same genre as we saw for the Mozart example I gave you. So each voice singing the same line, but coming in one at a time, creates this moment where one cannot even hear the words anymore, but just these syllables together with this strong rolling R's and this P. And also it's a good example of the famous Rossini crescendo. So the climax is mounting until you reach the words, delirar. So it's delirating, reaching the top volume and the highest complexity. So a great example of how Rossini could deal with the libretto and take the best out of them. The last example is also to show you how opera was a good place for linguistic experimentation. So experimentation with Italy, also stretching the boundaries of the language itself. This happens a lot in of course, for obvious reason, in comic opera, where the puns and playing with words is very common, but also in a very important opera by maybe a lesser known composer, Arrigo Boito, who was famous as a composer at his time, but also as a librettist himself. He also wrote the libretto for his own operas and for some operas, for example, by Verdi. So we can connect to Verdi, which will be important in the last part of this lecture. So he wrote, for example, the libretto for the Otello and the Falstaff, some later operas by Verdi. And he himself, he wrote a couple of operas. So unlike Rossini, who wrote 40 operas before he was even 40 years old of age, Arrigo Boito only wrote one single opera, the Mephistophele, based on Goethe's Faust. And then he worked for 50 years on a second opera that he never finished. It was supposed to be an opera based on the character of Nero, the Roman emperor. So the example I will play for you now is an aria by Mephistophele that is a bass aria. And I just want that you notice how Boito, who is very modernist in the use of Italian, plays with words, and ultimately words are not even enough to express the nature of devil. And the only thing the devil can do is to whistle to express all of his anger. So you have the lyrics here of the first verse, then we will stop it. With the translation. The performance is a live performance by Bryn Terfel, the great bass.
Son lo spirito che nega sempre tutto l'astra il fior il mio ghigno e la mia vega turban gli ozi al creator voglio il nulla e del creato la ruina universal la ruina universal e atmosfera mia vital e atmosfera mia vital e atmosfera mia vital ciò che chiamasi ciò che chiamasi peccato ciò che chiamasi peccato ciò che chiamasi peccato mostre Possibile fischio, 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 fischio.
I will stop it here, just making sure that it's quite amazing that actually the direction asked the singer to whistle this. At the end, this is an aria portraying Mephistopheles, the devil. But of course, some singers cannot sing that, cannot whistle that loud and that well. He actually does that himself. So that's quite impressive. Sometimes they need to ask the help from someone in the orchestra to whistle for them or to use an instrument to do that. Okay, so there were just very few examples of important spots in the history of operas to just to give you some of the idea of the possibilities that for the composers when it comes to playing with the language. Now I wanted to have you listen into some pieces of music that are written for guitar but based on opera tunes. This is actually a very common way of interpreting opera arias. It was the most famous to do that was the pianist Franz Liszt, who wrote several fantasies and variations on opera themes, taking opera, for example, by Verdi and playing piano, composing piano fantasies over them. But also by Niccolo Paganini on violin, and even Chopin, who is not very famous for that, but he, for example, he wrote a set of variations of an aria by Mozart, from the Don Giovanni by Mozart. So on guitar, we can find pretty much the same thing, and I will have you listening my a recording from a couple of concerts that I had in last year in Asia. I was in Taiwan, the video that you will see. So two operas by Verdi, two of the most famous opera. The first one is the Il Trovatore, which you know doesn't need many introductions, but the fantasy itself was written by a Bohemian composer that you can see in the picture on the right, Johann Caspar Merz. In this fantasy, it's a collection of different arias. I want to play for you beforehand the short excerpt of an aria from the Trovatore that you will actually hear in the guitar piece, so that you can recognize it. Is an aria by Azucena, the gypsy. A gypsy character of the opera, who tells us how she swore revenge for the death of her mother. So.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, I have to cut it, but just to give you an idea of the tune that you will be able to recognize in the guitar piece that I'm gonna share with you now. Should be this one. Thank you. Okay, I need to move very quickly to the next piece. First, let me open this. Okay, and then I should move back to the previous slide. Let's see if it works. Okay. Okay, do you all see the Traviata slide with, no, is it, how about this? Okay, good. Okay, so last, another piece based on, another fantasy based on a Verdi opera, the Traviata, which together with the Trovatore and the Rigoletto forms the so-called popular trilogy by Verdi, an opera composed in 1853. This fantasy is composed by a Spanish guitar composer, Francisco Tárrega. I would not spend many words introducing that, but it again is a collection of different arias, of which a very famous one that I will play very few seconds for you, performed by the great soprano Maria Callas. The aria Sempre Libera. It's really sad to stop this, but you will hear the same theme at the end of this composition by Francisco Tárrega. Let's see if it works. Okay, and play. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Okay, I hope you enjoyed this last piece as well. I wanted just to say goodbye and finish this lecture, and then I will be available for some questions if you have some. With a very short piece, kind of an encore, written by an Italian composer, a famous Italian composer who passed away this year, Ennio Morricone, who was very famous for soundtracks, also for Hollywood. And so this is a short arrangement of a beautiful piece from the movie The Mission. Let me open this first and then share it. Okay. Share screen. Okay. Okay, I hope you also like this last small piece, beautiful piece of music by Morricone, and I hope also you enjoyed this lecture and these bits of music that I had you listen. So if you have any question, as Arianna was suggesting, just raise your hand or type in the chat. I can see some messages in the chat, so. Maybe Arianna can lead the conversation from now on, but I really want to thank all of you for being with me today. So
thank you, Carlo, for this wonderful hour together. And it was very moving, especially the last the last piece that you played for us. It was, you know, I had a feeling that we had to switch off our lights and be together in this kind of, you know, of audience recreated in a theater like, and it was a wonderful feeling that we had of, you know, being present to your music. So let's also see what they write in the chat, and starting also from some comments. Cynthia, so beautiful, moving, and such a pleasure to enjoy. And also what Anna Sino says, l'Italia e gli italiani hanno sempre l'illuminazione, la grande di trasformare in ogni oro ogni cosa che toccano creano. Okay, this is what it means. It means Italians have always this kind of light, enlightenment, this idea, this way of transforming into gold whatever they touch or create. So it's a beautiful comment from Anna to you as a musician and to Italians' creativity, whether it's music, science, or arts, or fashion, or food, or finance even here, since it was created in Florence. So the first banks were in Tuscany, sure. And a lot of compliments. And do you have any questions? Anyone who wants to raise their hands or have any questions for Carlo?
Well, I want also to say again, thank you for these beautiful comments, and take the chance again for thanking my beautiful cousin Cynthia for joining me today, my friends. Mark and Dennis and Mary Alice and Jim, and I see other friends as well. I'm very happy to have all of you here today.
I see there are also some teachers from our Dante Language School, and I think, and also from UBC Department of Italian Studies. And I think we learned a lot also about how I didn't know, for example, about Rousseau and what he said about the Italian language. So it's something that we can also integrate in our lessons in the future. And so if you please repeat the name of the guitarist question. What does it mean? Please repeat the name of it. How we pronounce it? Carlo Fierens.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes. How to pronounce your surname, Carlo Fierens, or Carlo, if you want to add anything to the...
Carlo Fierens is clearly not an Italian last name. It's my grandfather came from Belgium, so that's where the name come from.
I just have one question. Since you played Ennio Morricone's one of Ennio Morricone's song, do you think there has been a kind of... So Ennio Morricone was under-evaluated and undervalued as just a musician who did music scores for Hollywood, for films. But he was a great musician, and that perhaps now we are starting to honor him in a different way.
Yeah, that's, you're perfectly right. Actually, he started as a trained musician, actually as an avant-garde composer, you know, a very modernist composer, and his first compositions are not that, you know, audience friendly at all. They actually sound very modern and sharp, but then he moved on into this very personal style of composing for the film industry, and which is really an art in itself. We cannot think of some of the movies of the Italian Westerns, the so-called spaghetti Westerns, or even some of, you know, Quentin Tarantino's most famous movies without the music of Morricone. So he was really able to capture the essence of each movie and transfer it to music. And so he was, by the end of his life, he was really recognized as one of the most important Italian living composers, and also he enjoyed great popularity touring with orchestras and performing his music live, so also as a conductor of his own music. So really a great figure that we lost this year.
So if you don't have any more questions, and it's already late into the night for you, we would like to thank again Carlo for this beautiful time together and for what we learned from him and the joy that and the pleasure that he gave us, I mean, by just listening to his music. For Jill, who asked, she didn't know whether the guitarist was you when they performed those pieces. Mm. Yes, Jill, that was still him who played those pieces and for us.
1 year ago, I don't know if I changed that much, but maybe I should shave or...
It's the COVID lockdown look.
Right.
Yes. So thank you everyone for joining us tonight, and let's hope to see each other again on these same screens in the future. Thank you to
grazie
everyone.
Grazie mille.
Thank you.
Grazie.
Grazie tante, grazie.
Grazie mille. Arrivederci, buonanotte a tutti, good night to everyone, and good day to you, Carlo. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Grazie.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.